you some boogie we will for the Fringe FM. Coming at you live from the middle of nowhere, the center of everywhere, here once again to give you yet another dose of conversational boogie. This is Shift Happens. Well, we're kind of live, and a little bit more on that in a minute. Actually, no, a little bit more on that right now. So, ladies and gentlemen, here's what we're going to do tonight. Yeah, by the way, I see you, Jimmy, over there, boogieing down. There you go. All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, what we're doing tonight. So, this weekend is the first annual catapult contest. That's right. There's a catapult. There's cats. There's 300 yards of foam. And that's right. Pick your favorite or least favorite cat. Strap them in and get ready. Oh, wait. No. That's not this weekend. No, this weekend is the Conscious Life Expo. Although somebody should probably look into starting that catapult thing. That sounds like a good idea. But yeah, so this weekend we've got the Conscious Life Expo, which means we are going to be too busy to do a show on Friday. So what we're doing is we're pre-recording a show. So by the time you hear this, this happened a couple of days ago. And what we're going to do is we're going to run this live, or from your perspective, this is running live. So that way, although it's not live, at least you guys can all hang out in the chat room and you guys get a new episode and we don't have to miss the conference. And so it all works out for all parties involved. So there you have it. And at least that's the plan. That is the plan. I do have a backup plan in case everything blows up. You're still going to hear the show anyway. So no worries. You're still listening to it. It's still Friday night for you. And so there you go. And with that, so we do have... So obviously Cortana's not back yet. And Darren McClure had to take a leave of absence tonight. So pinch hitter for tonight. Weighing in at a solid... Well, I don't know how much he weighs, but at a coming in at a height of... Well, I don't know how... tall he is either, but he's taller than me and he weighs more than me. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, our associate producer Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter, ADS Brad Harris. What's happening, Brad?
How are you doing, my kung fu master? Very good. Oh. Actually, I'm doing good, just chilling. Can't wait to hear from our friend Jimmy and Kelly and get a little bit of fun going on tonight. The weather's cold down here. I know the weather's boring to talk about, but damn, it's cold. Anyways, yeah, let's break it down.
Yeah, man, it really is cold. And actually, for the moment, I'm actually back in Arizona for... I'm going to be here for a couple of weeks. Well, except for Conscious Life. I'm going to be here for a couple of weeks and then back out to California. And yeah, it's kind of... I can't believe it's so cold out here. It's unbelievable. But... enough about the weather. We're gonna cut the in fact I did a whole commercial about that, didn't I? But yeah, so yeah, I want to kind of cut the intro short tonight because we've got a couple of good folks here. We've got Jimmy Pearson and Kelly Farmer. You know them from from Explaining Esoterica, for one, which is Kelly's show that Jimmy helps out with, and then Fascination Street, which Jimmy does with his son Mika, and both up and coming shows. They, you know, it was just seems like 5 minutes ago these shows didn't exist, and then yeah, I've definitely seen Kelly around at a few events lately. Next thing you know, she's got a show going, and she's got some. You know, I was looking at the roster of guests earlier today, and man, you know, she's got. She's killing it so far. Listen to that interview with Steve Barillo. That's a good interview right there. And so, yeah, can't wait to talk to those guys. And we'll get to that in just a second. But real quick, let's go ahead and bing, bam, boom, get the sponsors out of the way. And, well, real quick update, Brad. Any update on the with Adrian Valera and the whole beach cleanup thing?
Yeah, we're combining up into April. I think it's April 7th we're looking at right now. And we're going to have a beach cleanup. We're going to do it with combined with the coastal cleanup crew. And it's going to be kind of a coalition of two or three groups getting together and doing it. We're going to knock out all of the southern Orange County from, like, Newport all the way down within, look some more of the information on that. We'll give you the website too as well.
All right, good deal. And man, there's a frog in my throat. Speaking of things coming up, this March, me, Brad Olson, Jeff Rennell, Tom Dongo, Eric Awakening Man, there's a few others that may or may not tag along, but we're going out to, so it's going to be March 13th, 14th, and 15th. We're going on a little expedition. We're getting a little RV, and everybody's bringing everything. Brad Olson's got all kinds of night vision stuff. I think he's got a time travel machine or something. And, Polk's got his night vision goggles and, you know, just every piece of equipment that you can possibly detect anything with. We're going out there, guns blazing. We are going to find something. Whether it's Bigfoot, UFOs, something. We're going to find something. And we're also going to do a live broadcast from there. So that's going to be the weekend of, I could very well be getting these dates wrong. But it's around the 13th, 14th, or 15th. And, and I'll keep you posting on that. We're going to try to do a live broadcast from there. Although the more we look into it, the more it's not really possible because we're going to be out in the middle of nowhere. We'll keep you posted on that. And so there you have it. All right, real quick. See if I can break record time here. This show is brought to you by Pure Health Defenders. That's right, the makers of C7 Tech and C-Miracle. C-Miracle being a sea vegetable-based supplement made of 7 different sea vegetables, each one individually sourced from the most pristine location around the world. Absolutely the best stuff you can have, as well as C7 Tech, which I know Jimmy here has got his C7 Tech on, and so does Brad, and so do I. And it uses scalar technology and atomic technology and scalar energy. What it does is it realigns the blood flow and the energy flow in your body, and it just corrects everything. And, you know, especially, there you go. And for somebody like me, you know, that grew up skateboarding, you know, I've broken all kinds of toes and fingers and everything. And so when you have those damaged spots, what happens is you don't get a lot of blood there, you don't get a lot of energy flow there, and those parts kind of suffer. But within 10 minutes of putting this thing on, when you do the thermal imaging, you can see, like, live, your body starts correcting the energy flow and the blood flow, and it's getting to those areas. And
you don't suck anymore. And then you're ripping again.
Exactly. There you go. And there's all kinds of other benefits, too, even with plants as well. And if you go to purehealthdefenders.com, there's all kinds of studies there. If you scroll down the homepage down towards the bottom in the middle, if you have like any questions about it, everything is explained right there. And if you want to order anything from Pure Health Defenders, make sure you use the promo code SHIFTHAPPENS and you will save yourself 50% off of every order. Free shipping, lifetime, money-back guarantee, no bullsh. There you go. Bam, son. We're also brought to you by Flax C60. That's right, that's Darren's brainchild of C60. The only C60 that you can get with flax oil as the delivery method, which has plenty of extra benefits attached to that. And if you want to go and, you know, we talk about this all the time. If you don't know about C60, first of all, how dare you? Second of all, look it up. There's a really good interview with, Ken Powers. We've had him on the show too, but honestly, there's a really good interview with Ken Powers. What's his name? Wait, is that his name?
Austin.
Schwartz, brah.
Schwartz. Ken Schwartz. Who is Ken Powers?
May the Schwartz be with you.
Ken Schwartz. Anyway, but yeah, look him up. He did an interview with Patty Greer. It's a couple hours long, and he really, he just explained it really well. That's definitely something I would recommend looking into. And if you want to get some Flax C60, go to flaxc60.com. Use the promo code SHIFTHAPPENS10. You'll save yourself 10% off of every order. We're also brought to you by Coinbase. You know what it is. If you're interested in getting into cryptocurrency, the most easy, user-friendly way to do it is signing up through Coinbase. And if you sign up through our affiliate link at our website, shifthappenspodcast.com, look for the banner at the top right of the page. Click that, and if you sign up that way, you will get $10 free worth of Bitcoin after you make your first deposit of $100 or more in whichever cryptocurrency you choose. All right, what was that, like 4 minutes? That was pretty good, right?
You did pretty good.
All right. <Not bad. laughs> All right, and without any further ado whatsoever, the one, the only, Jimmy Pearson and Kelly Farmer. What's going on, guys?
Hello there.
Hey.
All right, good to have you guys here. Now,
Buenos dias. And noches and all that good stuff.
Now, I think it's worth noting that, what is it, like 4 in the morning over there, Jimmy? You're over there in England, right?
Yeah, we're 20 to 4 in the morning. So, yeah.
Wow, yeah. Sorry you had to get up so early for this.
It's totally worth it.
And, you know, because really, this kind of worked out in multiple ways. Because for one, first of all, you know, Kelly's show and ours, we go live at the same time. So really, there would be no other way to have her on the show, on our main show anyway, either way. And then for two, obviously the time difference between you two, as it is. So it's kind of a miracle that we actually have all these people here at once. So I'm pretty excited about this because this is a pretty rare
synchronicity place. And everything. It's there.
Absolutely. Now, so if you guys don't know, Kelly Farmer, she has her show Explaining Esoterica, which you can catch on YouTube. Just right there, type in Explaining Esoterica. The channel should pop right up, as far as I know. At least it did for me. And then Jimmy Pearson, he does a show called Fascination Street with his son, Mika. And by the way, how old is your son?
He's 10.
10 years old, and he's co-hosting a show already. How about that?
That's right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Congrats. Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, I think Jimmy Church dubbed him Britain's youngest ufologist, and I think he was pretty much on the money for that one as well.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know any other. Yeah, I mean, that's pretty. So did he? So I got to ask you, did he? I mean, obviously you're fascinated in all these different subjects that you talk about and whatnot, but did he sort of kind of see what you're doing and just kind of like followed in your footsteps and that whole kind of thing?
Well, I mean, when I started off doing a podcast, and with that came obviously lots of research, lots of documentary watching and things like that. So, I mean, me and my son are very, very close anyway. So if I'm sat there watching a documentary, you know, he'd probably come and curl up on the sofa with me and we'd end up watching it together. And he sort of like slowly become fascinated by the whole sort of like Area 51 thing. But like even prior to that, I mean, we used to go out and we used to do like camping together. So we'd be doing a lot of like sky watches, the Perseid meteor shower, etc., in like August and things like that. So there was always that, the kind of wonder, you know, was that a meteor? What's that moving over there? So there was always kind of that fascination and that wonder.
Right. And, you know, there really is something about, you know, kids these days, like a 10-year-old today is way smarter than 10-year-olds were when I was 10. You know, like, for example, just yesterday, you know, there's this like really popular game called Fortnite that like all my friends are playing. And I never really, I just never got into it. I finally, they like basically got it for me. Like, dude, come play. I'm like, all right. You know, so I get on there yesterday and some random kid ends up joining our group, right? And I could tell he's really little. I thought maybe he was like 10 or 11 or 12. And this kid is like showing me the ropes. He's explaining everything to me. He's showing how to do everything. And here's the kicker. This kid was 5 years old. 5 years old.
Serious.
I swear to God. At first I thought he was joking. But then like he kept like saying like, no, like I'm actually 5. And I heard his mom in the background. I'm like, hold on. Put your mom on here. Let me ask her how old you are. Like, is your son actually 5 years old? And she was like, yeah. I'm like, I can't believe it. I mean, this when I was 5, I was a dummy. And this kid is...
Yeah. And this kid's like... I was still out in the garden eating chalk.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I was probably chewing on a Hot Wheels car, right? Yeah.
Yeah, right, dude.
Yeah, there really is... kids are getting smarter and smarter earlier and earlier on. And I can only imagine this is going to keep going in that direction, I would think.
What do you think that is, Gigi?
You know, that's a really great... I think a lot of it is, quite honestly, the internet and the exchange of information. Yep. There's just simply, you know, I mean, I remember, like, my dad was, like, the first person in our neighborhood to, like, have the internet back in, like, 94. And, you know, I remember very clearly all the kids would come to our neighborhood because we wanted to look up the cheats to Mortal Kombat, right? And I was the only person that could
do it.
Yeah,
right.
So we would, you know, we would type in the thing, we'd click the link. It would take 10 minutes to load the page, right? Like 10 minutes just to load a page of text. And then it turns out, oh, man, we clicked the wrong link. So then you have to go back and wait 10 more minutes and then click the right link and wait 10 minutes. But now it's just lightning. You know, you can, any question you have, you just bam, you get a million answers right away. And then, you know, you see kids walking around with, you know, iPhones like 4 or 5 years old and they're, you know, it's, they know how to work YouTube. They know how to, you know, filter Google results. And there's, I think the internet has a lot to do with that. Yeah. Although there has to be other factors, right? I'm just not sure what they are. What do you think?
Well, I don't know. Kelly?
I think that a lot of parents are kind of more aware and they want their kids to, you know, get ahead. So they're exposing their kids to more, in my opinion, you know, kind of pushing them a little bit more than like when we were kids and our parents were kind of more along the lines of, you know, let kids be kids, go out and play and all that stuff. But I'm seeing a lot of parents putting their kids in, you know, like classes and exposing them to a lot more information. So I think that has at least something to do with it.
Yeah.
I mean, like with Mika, I mean, you know, at the age of 8, I mean, he hiked up Britain's second highest mountain for charity. We do a lot of like outdoor stuff together, a lot of hiking. And we do like a lot of active meditation together and bits and pieces like that as well. I think it's really important as a parent if you can kind of strike the balance and if your kids can get into what you get into. I mean, anyone can kind of, you know, go out and spend an evening in the garden with the kids, but you've got to make it interesting. You know, look up there. Look, is that star moving? Watch that. And then again, you know, that creates it. I mean, because, you know, I mean, I don't know how old you guys are, but I mean, like growing up in sort of like the early 80s and that, the whole world was just a wonder of science fiction with like, you know, Star Wars and all the other bits and pieces that were coming out, Battlestar Galactica, things like that. And it made space really, really cool.
Yeah. And I think there's definitely something as awesome as it is. And obviously we're, you know, we're seeing the fruits of the, you know, of this, you know, and that is kids being smarter much earlier on. But at the same time, I feel like there's a little aspect of childhood that's kind of being skipped over. And that is, you know, like when I skate, you know, past like a park or whatever, I'll see, you know, a bunch of kids playing around and all their parents are there, but all of their parents are sitting there staring at phones. And then all the kids are sitting there staring at phones. Like, well, you know, you're at a park, you know, and you know, there's all kinds of things to do. And then also other, just little things like, Halloween, for example, back in the day, you know, our parents just, you know, we would ride our bikes like miles away because we heard a rumor that this other neighborhood over here has the full size Snicker bars, right? So we would make a whole trek over there. Good luck doing that today. Your parents aren't going to let you go 5 feet away from them. You know, it's like this real monitored thing. Like kids don't get to run around and explore like we used to back in the day. And so I guess it's kind of give and take. Like, yeah, we've got smarter kids, but I kind of wonder, like, are we fast forwarding through their childhood? Like the kind of childhood that we had, you know, but I probably just sound like an old man right now, but,
we got to give them that chance like we did, you know, and I think it kind of helps if you can revert back to being a bit of a child yourself, because I mean, like up behind where I live, about a 10-minute walk, we have like miles of old Napoleonic fortresses that we used to go in and raid when we were kids and things like that. And I still try and make it fun with Mika and kind of do the same thing with him. And then kind of get that buzz of like those summer past when you kind of down there with your mates and things like this. And that's kind of cool.
Yeah, we got so many fortresses here, Jimmy. So many Napoleonic fortresses in the United States.
Absolutely. Yeah, I've seen the castle at the end of your road and everything.
Oh man.
Yeah, I would love to have Mika and my son Jonah meet someday. They're like around the same age, and that'd be cool if you guys can ever make it out to California and teach you guys how to surf and stuff. It'd be fun.
I'm trying to get them out here.
Yeah, when do you think? Awesome. Yeah, when do you think? Well, first of all, yeah, Brad's son Jonah is definitely just like your son. He's one of those kids that's just like light years ahead of, you know, kids his age, and he's like, I've had some conversations with him before. Like, I can't believe I'm having this conversation with this kid. Like, he actually knows what I'm talking about. This is crazy. So, but yeah, when do you think? You know, kind of like we were talking about before the show. You know, obviously a lot of these events and stuff like Conscious Life and whatnot are all happening out here. And obviously, you would fit right in. And I mean, you know half of everybody anyway. So when are we going to see you out here?
When we can afford it. Right. It's the bottom line.
All right.
I hear that. Is that a, now what?
Yeah.
I've seen that hat there. Oh, by the way, folks, you guys don't have the video here, but we're looking at Jimmy and Kelly here. What is that hat? It kind of looks like the Secure Team alien, but it's not. What is that? What is that logo?
It is. It's a Zeta. Yeah.
So okay.
It's just the standard.
I should probably know that by now, but I've seen it around quite a bit. I've seen it in a few photos of yours. Yeah, I was just kind of curious about that. Okay. There you go. Uh oh. Hold on. Could this be? Could it be? No, it's not. Oh, I thought Darren was about to come in. Okay, never mind. So now.
Yes. No, the hat was a it was one of our early I don't know what you'd call it. It was both me and Mika had them, and they were kind of like, it was like our identity, and we've kind of kept them going because not only that, they're really comfortable hats.
Yeah, it looks really comfortable. It looks like it's made out of some kind of futuristic, the Orville sort of material there. Yeah.
It's kind of like, looks like a meshing over the top. It's really nice.
Yeah, there he goes. Is it like a one-size-fit-all kind of thing, or does it have a little strap at the back?
No, it's a snapback.
Okay. See, I can't do the snapbacks. Can't do them. I don't know what it is. Can't do them. You're rocking it, though. Keep on rocking it.
Thank you.
Keep on rocking it. So so we mentioned before, you know, Kelly's show goes live from 7 to 9 on Fridays, and that's on YouTube. And now, are there any other – well, first of all, so your show goes live at, what do you say, 12 on Saturdays in England, right?
12 PST, which is 8 p.m. UK time.
Oh, okay. That makes more sense. All right. So there you go. Yeah. And that's good. That's perfect because there really is – I mean, no offense to anybody else, but there's really no good shows on in the middle of Saturday. You know, so that's a really good time slot for you to – come on. And I'm so that's on YouTube, obviously. Is there anywhere else or
yep,
where all can
no we I mean, we started on we started with a podcast on Anchor, then we started going live through Facebook, and then yeah, we made YouTube our home. So yeah, we're good there. We like YouTube.
And then there's also the fact that occasionally we have a crossover show where we do it together, and that replaces the Fascination Street for that week. So that would be Esoterica Street, just to make things more complicated.
Yeah, let's complicate it, right? it's like the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, you know? We kind of come together to create one, like, unstoppable force.
Yeah, it's just like a Megazord of radio, right? Yes.
You got this.
Trust me, son. I used to watch Power Rangers for a living when I was a kid.
Right.
You will never outranger me,
dude. Especially on Halloween, I remember I got the when the Green Ranger came out. I don't know if you guys remember that.
Oh, I remember the Green Ranger. I used to think he was so cool, and then he became the White Ranger.
Me too. And I swear to God, I had to have been the first kid with that costume. There was no other kids with that costume.
That's pretty cool.
Hell yeah, I'll take that to the grave, son. All right, now I do want to get into okay, we only have a couple minutes till the break, and my question is going to warrant a much longer answer. So what we're going to do is take a break a little bit early, and then we'll get back to the business after this commercial break.
Yeah, from Power Power Rangers to business. That's good.
There you go. How else would you have it? How else would you have it? Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here on the Fringe FM. And once again, just a quick reminder, although this is streaming live, this is a pre-recorded show that we did a couple of days ago. So all of your questions in the chat room, we're not going to be able to answer, obviously, because the show already happened. But at least you guys get to hang out together in the chat room. So there you go. And the reason why, because by the time you're listening to this, we are at the Conscious Life Expo. There you go. So ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back here in just a few short minutes after this commercial break. Don't go anywhere.
When you're always on the go, it can be a hassle getting the proper servings of veggies and fruits into your everyday diet. Life gets hectic, making it hard for us to always make healthy food choices. Not to mention it's pretty expensive. Wouldn't it be great to ditch the long grocery store lines, but still get your fruits and veggies all at once? What you need is Balance of Nature Fruits and Veggies Capsules, made with 31 of the highest quality fruits and vegetables and grown right here in the USA. Balance of Nature is 100% natural, safe, and affordable. For a limited time, use discount code TALK and you'll get 35% off your first preferred set of Balance of Nature Fruit and Veggie Capsules, along with free shipping. Call 1-800-246-8751 today. Ready for the real results you want and need? Then you need Balance of Nature. Call 1-800-246-8751. That's 1-800-246-8751 and use code TALK.
From birth, we have been conditioned to conform to what is normal, conditioned to adhere to authority, and conditioned to repeat what has been told to us as truth. I'm Ryan Gable, and here at The Secret Teachings Radio, I've interviewed hundreds of great guests and done extensive unique research into subjects that span from the paranormal and the occult to health, philosophy, and history. I personally have no affiliations or agenda, except to use objective critical thinking in my analysis of every subject discussed, to empower myself with information, and hopefully allow you to do the same. If you want to join me, tune into the Secret Teachings radio broadcast, airing live Monday through Friday from midnight to 3 a.m. U.S. Pacific Standard Time on The Fringe FM. For more information, you can visit our website at www.thesecretteachings.info or email me at rdgable@yahoo.com.
Pure Health Defenders, proud sponsor of Shift Happens, producing organic and natural health, wellness, and technology products for people, pets, and plants to thrive alive. Pure Health Defenders, also known as PHD, is powered by C7 Technology, Scalar Energy Atomic Technology, and fueled by Sea Miracle Superfoods. 118 nutrients of the purest sea vegetables Mother Earth has to offer. Recognized 100% by people, pets, and plants, delivering the value the same. Everybody deserves a PhD. Be smart about it. Come join the healthiest family today.
Kids, don't drink in park. Accidents cause people. This has been a PSA brought to you by your friends at Shift Happens and The Fringe FM.
Folks, this is very important information. What's to be said about CBD? AncientLifeOil.com. Our CBD is made from hemp and has 0.003 THC, which means this wonderful product won't get you high. No matter what amount you take, what does CBD do for the body? My hands are tied, but you can Google CBD benefits and be astounded. When you're finished reading, you'll want to log on to AncientLifeOil.com. That's AncientLifeOil.com. and purchase. Life is good when you feel good. People are tired of pain. People are asking for non-GMO organic products to help them with you fill in the blank. Legal in 49 states, and again, our CBD is made from hemp. Ancient Life Oil is about helping people, one by one by one. If you wonder how good the product is, the CEO takes it every day without miss. AncientLifeOil.com. That's AncientLifeOil.com. Have a great day.
Who were the real ancient Egyptians? What is it about ancient Egypt that captivates us all? The critically acclaimed series Magical Egypt is back with all new episodes. Let Chance Gardner and company take you on another adventure through Magical Egypt in the new series Magical Egypt 2. Magical Egypt 2 attempts a forensic reconstruction of the science of the ancients through a study of ancient aesthetics. Also, the best researchers and authors in the field like John Anthony West, Graham Hancock, Laird Scranton, Robert Louval, Lon Malo Duquette, Aaron Cheek, and more join together to explore the topics of the esoteric and the hidden messages of the ancient Egyptians. Just go to MagicalEgypt.com right now and put in the code word FRINGE and get 10% off any download or order, including the groundbreaking original Magical Egypt series, as well as the new episodes in Magical Egypt 2. Also, check out the great work and the companion series at MagicalEgypt.com. Click the banner on the Fringe FM or go to MagicalEgypt.com and use the code word FRINGE and get 10% off your order today while it lasts.
KTLK Digital Broadcasting. We rock the paranormal talk.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
This is Shift Happens. I'm your host, GG, along with my pinch hitter guest host for the night, Brad Harris, our associate producer. And so, real quick reminder for everybody listening right now, this is, although it's a live stream, this is a pre-recorded show that we did a couple of days ago. And the reason why is because at the time of you hearing this, we are at the Conscious Life Expo getting our boogie on. So, but we still wanted to
Gigi's
have a...
Gigi's like three whiskeys deep right now.
Probably. Well, I should be. Actually, I'm working on it. I'm working on it. Well, that reminds me, I need to take my C60, son. How there dare I go. Not take that today? So, even though you guys are alive in the chat room, obviously we can't answer your questions. So I just want to make that very clear. I'm probably going to have to repeat this a couple of times throughout the show. And even then, some people are still going to wonder why we're not responding to them. So I hope that you guys get what's going on here. we wanted you guys to have a show for Friday. We wanted a place for you guys to hang out. And at the same time, we wanted to be at the conference. So this was the only way to do it. So
letting you know.
So there you go.
For sure.
Now, let's get back. So, ladies and gentlemen, we've got Jimmy Pearson and Kelly Farmer on here from Fascination Street and Explain the Esoterica, respectively. Now, so like I was going to ask before the show, so Jimmy, you're in England, and Kelly, you're in California. Now, real quick, Jim, which part of England are you at?
I'm in the southeast. I'm in Kent, which is known as the Garden of England, and I'm also living in a town which is the closest part to mainland Europe.
Oh, there you go. All right, good deal. How long does it take to get through that? Do they still have that tunnel that goes over there?
Yeah, we've got the Channel Tunnel. That's probably about half an hour, but I'm actually a sailor on the ferries that go from Dover to France.
Oh, nice. So how does that work? You just sail right on over there? Do they have like a passport check?
Well, I mean, we don't get off on the other side, but normally, if you're going over as a passenger, then yeah, you get off and passport, and then that's it. You're there. You're in Europe. You know, you can go absolutely anywhere from there.
Seems like it'd be pretty easy to just kind of scuba dive your way over there, undetected. You know, and just kind of pop up.
Well, we have quite an immigrant problem right now, and we have so many coming over in little like kids rubber dinghies and things like that. Every single day in the news, sort of like locally, they're picking up like 19, 20 like immigrants a day that are making their way over from mainland France.
Yeah, you know, if it were me, you know, if I were living in England, I would get one of those water seal proof little coolers. Scuba dive over to France, get some of that fancy cheese, stick it in there, and scuba dive right back. And that's how you get your secret recipe at your English restaurant over there. They wonder, where do you get this cheese? I don't know. Not telling you. And that's how you do it. So so now being...
you do send out little food parcels to Kelly every now and then for like the British food that she can't get out there. So, yeah.
Yeah. Now, very okay. Jack in it. So speaking of that... how exactly, you know, because you guys work together quite a bit. From what I understand, you produce, you're one of the producers anyway over there with explaining Esoterica. Am I correct?
Jimmy comes on to explaining Esoterica once in a while as a co-host occasionally, but I'd run the tech for Fascination Street.
Oh.
So I guess it's opposite of
yeah,
what
so think. I had it backwards. Okay. Okay. Well, now we got that out of the way. But either way, still kind of so I'm still just as curious. How exactly did you end up working together since you're like halfway across the world from each other? How'd you guys meet? How did this all come about? No hurry.
Hello. Sorry, lost a bit there. Well, Kelly was working on another show at the time, she was working with a friend.
Stacey Herrick, if anybody's familiar with Stacey. Can you hear me?
Oh, so,
yep, you just caught up. You kind of froze for a second.
Yeah, your screen glitched out for a second there. I think everybody's back in tune now, right? Okay.
All right.
Yep.
So let's try again. Okay, so I was doing a show before with my sister and Stacey Herrick, if anybody knows who that is. And basically it was through Stacey, she introduced us to Jimmy, and then me and Jimmy became very good friends. So.
Okay. So that means that you mean like physically, like you were both in the same place?
No. Okay. She introduced us through Twitter.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, some of my best friends that I have today, I actually met through Twitter. And especially in this community, you know, it's funny, you know, because Twitter seems to be, I don't know, in all the different things I've been involved with, whether it's like music or skateboarding, like nobody gives a dick about Twitter. But in this community, Twitter is like the number one, you know, a lot of our promotion goes there and a lot of the audience shares links and everything through there. And it's a really great platform, especially if you use TweetDeck. I don't know if you guys use TweetDeck, but once you use TweetDeck, mm-hmm. you never go back. Mm-hmm. And it just it changes the game, really. And like me and Cortana, for example, never would have met if it wasn't for Twitter. And mm-hmm. yeah, it's a pretty powerful thing. And sure enough, here you guys, kind of similar situation here. So
absolutely. I've spent years on Facebook because, I've only been in the community just over a year. I'm, you know, doing research and bits and pieces. And I was on Facebook for a long, long time, and I joined certain communities on there, and it just wasn't working for me. So I actually closed down my Facebook account and then made my way over to Twitter. And you are so right. Everything that I needed to find, people that I needed to find. I mean, I have people in my audience that have been with me since day one, since the first day I joined Twitter. You know, you just connect with certain people on there. I mean, it's brilliant. I love Twitter. I know everyone slates it and it probably doesn't get used as much, but in our community, you're so right, Gigi. It's spot on.
Yeah, and you're also right about the Facebook thing, because, you know, we're on Facebook too, but it's like we stopped promoting on Facebook. Like, there's kind of no point. Mm-hmm. We're just kind of wasting our time. Nobody's really looking there when it comes to this stuff. Like, Like, I've got, you know, I've got all kinds of friends. Like, I've got just as big of a thing going on Facebook, but that's all because of, like, skateboarding and stuff. Like, if I post something that doesn't have anything to do with, you know, skateboarding or music, then nobody cares at all. But then Twitter, it's the exact opposite. You know, I post about our stuff all the time. Like, it's all good. But I'll say one thing about skateboarding. Nobody cares. So there's obviously a separation in platforms going on, which is kind of interesting. But my favorite one right now, though, is definitely on Stellar. Are you guys on there?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I just think
I joined that from the auth, but I don't use it as much as I should do. So it's bad form, Jimmy. Bad form.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat on that one.
Oh man, you guys really should. It's really one of the best. You know, if you think Twitter's a good, well, it is. Twitter's a great platform for promoting and stuff, but we've gotten so many more new listeners from OnStellar. I can't tell you how many times we've trended number one, just not even really saying anything. Just like, hey, we're having this guy on Friday. Like, bam, we're trending number one. Like, oh, okay, I guess people are paying attention here. But the best part is, because you can go to the trending section, that's always good. But then you go to the new post section. So it doesn't matter who's popular or what. It's just chronological order. And every 20 or 30 minutes, somebody's post, it could be the most random person ever, but there's always some kind of great new information, a new discovery, a new documentary. It's just an endless rabbit hole of knowledge that's going on over there. And on top of that, the platform just works so great. I mean, even on a cell phone, it's lightning fast.
Yep.
And it's just, man, it's sharp. I'm really proud of those guys for doing that. Mm-hmm. And especially once the whole blockchain, OnStellar token thing kicks in, then it's going to be really beneficial for people like you and us that do these kind of shows.
Yeah, absolutely. I think also as well, the fact that it's not available in an app format at the moment is one of those as well. I think once it's available in an app format, then it will probably get a lot more hit.
And see, that's a thing. I've kind of talked to them about that too, which is if you go to it, you know, if you just open the Chrome browser on your phone and you go to OnStellar, it basically functions as if it were an app, but like it works just as good. But that's the problem, is there's a lot of people that are a little bit too lazy to take that extra step, so they're not going to go there. You know, like, it's only one extra step. You just type in you're pointing at yourself. Yeah.
I am that guy. I'm that lazy guy.
And you know what's ironic is, at least I find that it actually works better on the, like, I mean, it's flawless either way, but it's a little bit faster on the phone than it is on the computer. And, you know, I've got 400 megabit download speed Ethernet plugged into the router, and it's still faster on my phone. So, but yeah, they do need to come up with an app. And you know what else they need is a tech support number on Stellar. We've got plenty of people in our audience that are having trouble with the whole confirmation email thing. Just throwing that out there. There you go. Now,
you know, I mean, it is genuinely an amazing platform. And, you know, everyone should be so proud of what they managed to create, because, you know, it's what we need. It's you know, it's pure fringe made by people from the fringe. So yeah, it's grand, absolutely fantastic, and the idea and the whole community surrounding and everything, amazing, absolutely amazing.
Yeah, and you know, there's no advertisement. There's no. I have yet to see any sort of bullying at all whatsoever. Everybody's there to learn.
There's nothing there.
Everybody's there to share knowledge, and it's a truly beautiful little platform.
One of the other things I noticed as well is the amount of sort of like up and coming authors or musicians that are on there that are giving away their products free as well. I mean, you've got so many people there that are giving you like their free ebook, or like every now and then, like Brett from Inquire Within comes on and puts in a code so you can download his album and things like that. I mean, that's community right there, right?
Yeah, that's probably the best word. It's a real solid community, and everybody's on the same page. And even though we might have different opinions and views on things, we're all on the same page as far as we have this platform fair to everybody. Let's share what we got. And it's kind of like, you know, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, all mixed into one thing for our community specifically. And yeah, it's a beautiful thing. So yeah. Now I want to get to so Kelly, mm-hmm. One thing you and I have in common is I know one of your favorite things to talk about is, you know, lost civilizations and megalithic structures and whatnot. So
yes.
All right, so I've got a question for you.
Oh, okay.
You got to blow one up, you can visit one time, and you can stay at one forever. Which sites fit those situations?
Oh, that's hard.
Not to put you on the spot.
The thing, I don't want to...
I can almost see the smoke coming out of her ears.
I don't want to blow any of them up.
But you
that's
have to.
My biggest struggle.
You have to blow one of them up. That's part of the deal. Here, let's just start with which one would you stay at forever?
Which one would I stay at forever would probably be Stonehenge.
Really? That's
yeah,
not what I
because
thought.
I think that there's a lot there that we're not that we still haven't really uncovered. So.
Wow, I didn't see that answer coming. Interesting.
I know, but it's because we're already on the second, or even some people say third phase of it. So the original Stonehenge that was as it was built is totally different than the Stonehenge we see today.
Right.
And there's still pieces of that that's there that you can see, and they took some of those pieces and built it into the new Stonehenge. But the original Stonehenge was built as actually a moon calendar.
Yeah.
Rather than a solar calendar as the current one. So, and from what I know, there's also a lot of burial mounds, and one of the researchers that I've talked to before, and she's going to come on my show actually in about 3 weeks. She has found some evidence of elongated skulls in some of the people that are in the large mounds that are around there.
Yeah.
That were the builders of Stonehenge. So, yes.
Yeah. And that's one thing you pointed out right there that a lot of people don't quite, like you said, it's more of a it's really a lunar calendar rather mm-hmm. than a solar calendar. And mm-hmm. that fact just seems to go right over people's heads more often than not. Yeah, it's cool that you mentioned that. So now you've got, all right, so that's number one. Number two, now there's a place that you can only visit once that you've never visited. You only have one chance to visit another place. Which place are you going to pick?
Okay, that's hard too.
We don't ask the fluff questions around here.
I know you're asking the tough one. You know, I'd probably say I'm kind of torn between either saying the Great Pyramid and Egypt or Sango Blekli Tepe. Ooh. I'm kind of torn between the two because one, you know, obviously there's a lot of research that's already gone into it, and just to kind of see it would be cool. But on the other hand, there's this other one that, you know, there's still so much more to know about it, and it was buried and all this other stuff. So that's a hard one.
Yeah, no, that's a solid answer. It's, you know, because I thought about what I would answer too on these questions. And for that one, I actually had a three-way tie between Egypt, Göbekli Tepe, but I also tied it with Machu Picchu in Peru. Man, I can't wait to
Machu Picchu is a good one too.
Yeah. I mean, it's just how the hell did they do that? But anyway, so now to the third one. You gotta blow one up. Which one is it?
I don't know. I don't think I can blow any of them up.
See, I've got kind of a cheat answer for this one, but let's see what you come up with first.
You're so cruel, Gigi.
I know that's messed up.
All right, well, let me go ahead and tell you my cheat answer.
I was going to say Easter Island.
Easter Island is just so interesting, though. Like when you know, like the backstory behind the people.
But I think
there's like, some new news out too right now.
I think.
Want to blow it up. Yeah, that's true.
I mean, I think Brad actually kind of has a good point there in that, like, we've examined everything there is to examine there for the most part. Like, if we had to let something go, I think we could still retain all the information while letting it go at the same time. I don't even know if you thought about that when you said that, Brad, but that's how I would look at it. But okay, so here's my cheat answer.
I channeled that one.
Here's my cheat answer. It would be the what do you call them? Those, you know, in North America, those little guide stones that say the population has to be below 500,000.
Georgia Guidestones.
Yeah, the Georgia Guidestones. That's a cheating answer.
Yeah. Well, I did say it was a cheat answer. So
it's a good answer, though.
No, you know what, though? I'm thinking about it, and maybe Brad's answer is a good answer. If you had to blow up something, blow up Easter Island, because you're right. I mean, there's not a whole lot there. I have heard that there is new information, and I know that, like, Freddie Silva just completed a bunch of research there recently.
Ooh, Freddie Silva. I forgot about that guy. Yeah, we're losing her a little bit.
I would like to take this moment to point out that either Shift Happens, Esoterica Street, Explain Esoterica, and Fascination Street have absolutely nothing against the population of Easter Island. This is just a metaphorical conversation.
Yes, absolutely.
Other islands are available.
Yeah. Yeah, I hope. Oh, wait. She's almost kind of back.
You back?
Is it better?
All right. Yeah, we got you now.
Is it better or worse now?
It's about the same. Well, I mean, it's as good as it was when it was good.
Okay, hold on.
But not as bad as when it was bad.
Okay, I've switched to audio only.
Oh yeah, that'll probably
Hopefully
help.
Hopefully that. Will help.
Yeah. And also, maybe if you can. I don't know if you can plug in directly through an Ethernet port. That would probably help.
I was plugged in directly in the Ethernet port. That's the funny thing. I just switched to Wi-Fi and it got better.
That's weird. Okay, let me. Is your internet service provider Cox?
No.
Oh, really? Oh,
I'm sorry. It's Spectrum.
Really? Spectrum's usually like really good.
Yeah, I don't know. It's been hit. Sometimes it's great, and sometimes Cox I'm struggling sucks. Like this.
Yeah. Oh, Cox is the worst. Absolutely.
All right. Let me try plugging back the Ethernet back in and seeing if maybe it's better now that I switched to audio only, and maybe that'll.
Yeah. You sound. Yeah. It seems pretty good now.
All right.
Yeah. Like Jimmy said, definitely no. No personal offense to anybody living on that island. We're just talking about the megalithic aspects of it.
Yes.
And but it is really. You know, everybody knows about Easter Island, you know? We all, the big heads there, blah, blah, blah. We don't know how they got there. But no. Stop and look at it. How did these things get here? Like, look how big these things are. Look how much they weigh. Really, they did this with, you know.
Why they were there, but I don't believe it.
You know, like.
It was a Western kind of philosophy or theory. And they didn't even say how they got there, but they said that they were there for other Polynesian travelers to know that there was fresh water there on the island. I was like, come on, I need more information on that.
Well, what's interesting is like from what I've read, when you go there, when they discovered Easter Island, there were some of those still being made half done, and then they just suddenly stopped.
Yeah. See that? Yeah.
And so then it gets kind of weirder when you think about it that way. And, you know, the whole...
But aren't they buried, too? Like, there's, like, the other half are deeper in the soil.
Yeah, but they have, like, near the quarries where they, like, got the stone to make them. There's, like, some half-made ones that they had started making. And then obviously they had, you know, this change in resources, and then it caused them to start eating each other, but that's a whole nother story.
Hmm. Yeah, that is a whole nother
story. Well, that got thought quick.
Gnarly.
Yeah, and it's interesting that anybody, you know, thought to, like you were kind of saying, Brad, like, how did they know that there was even an island out there in the first place, and they went all the way out there, and, you know, that whole kind of thing, and it kind of, so many things kind of tie back to this, something that's come up a lot lately is the whole, you know, when you look at the Perry Reese map, which is, you know, this, I'm sure you guys are familiar, you know, it's that map from, was it 1500s or 1600s, and the whole globe is mapped quite perfectly, and including Antarctica before it was covered in ice. Well, wait a minute.
Exactly.
We didn't discover Antarctica until, like, the 1900s when Russia flew over it with the, whatchamacallit, radar scan thing. That was a terrible description of that technology. I apologize about that. but you all know what I'm talking about. And then, you know, of course, Perry Reese himself, he notes on the map, like, this is all taken from various different maps that preceded that map by hundreds of years, and you look at those maps and it goes back even further until the point we can't really trace it. So it's like, clearly there were some lost civilizations that they had a little bit of a better grip, or at least, well, for one, a better grip, and for two, the way they gripped it was different. You know, they used a different sort of technology that we just we're not privy to, like, whereas we're based more on silicon-based electronics, their technology might have been more based on, I would imagine, the ley lines, the magnetic ley lines and all that stuff. And I'm sure there's more than no reason at all as to why they have all these megalithic structures on these intersections of ley lines, and then they're tracking their points from there. And I'm kind of surprised that to this day, at least in public, we don't know, scientists don't know how all this stuff worked. For one, it probably doesn't help that they're still trying to tell, they're still teaching our kids, yeah, they built the pyramids with, chicken bones and dental floss. It's like, okay, well, we need to, we need to get past that point first and just at least admit globally, okay, we don't know what the hell's going on here. We don't know how they did it. We can't do it. And start from there. And I'm kind of, 2019 now? We're still not we're still not past that point.
Yeah. Kinda. Let's just go for a full system reset, right?
Right. Well, I mean, that's really, that point is kind of like what drives me and what really interests me with regards to, this whole segment of information is the fact that obviously there were lost civilizations and obviously they had knowledge that we don't currently have. So that's really like what I am looking for, with my own research. So yeah. I think you're right on the money with that one.
Yeah. And there's just, we got to cut to a break in a minute here, but yeah, there's just so much. There's so many brilliant minds on this planet, and just think about how many very intelligent, very well-educated people are focusing all of their brain power on old, Darwinistic ideas that, like, people like us, you and I, we all know, like, yeah, it's not quite that simple. There's a lot of other shift going on here. And, some of the brightest minds are caught, whether it's because they're afraid of losing their job in the archaeological field or what have you, where those minds are not being applied to the research that should be happening right now, which is, let's, before we figure out where we're going, before we start going to Mars and before we do all this stuff, let's figure out where the hell we came from. Let's figure out what the, kind of like Graham Hancock says. It's just, we have this sort of, the human species as a whole has this sort of amnesia. Like, we don't remember, like, where we came from. And I feel like we could, if we all collectively put our minds to it and all worked on this together. But anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow. So there you go. Bam. Take that. All right, so we're going to go ahead and take our next commercial break here. And once again, ladies and gentlemen, for those of you just tuning in, this is a pre-recorded show that is streaming live. That way you guys can hang out in the chat room, while in the meantime, as you're listening, we're over at the Conscious Life Expo, wishing you all a most happy Friday, and we hope you enjoy this show. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to Shift Happens here for The Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, along with my co-host for tonight, Brad Harris. We're here with Jimmy Pearson and Kelly Farmer. We'll be back here in just a few short minutes. Don't go anywhere.
GTLK Digital Broadcasting, the Friends.fm, Napa Valley, California, Little Rock, Arkansas.
Tired of talking about the weather? No shift. Well, Shift Happens is here to fulfill your desires. As you reach that point in life where you crave tantalizing conversation about reality, ufology, the occult, and the conspiracies within, while simultaneously finding yourself desperately in need of your very own theme music, which we've got plenty of that too. So be sure to tune in to Shift Happens every Friday night from 7 to 9 Pacific, right here on The Fringe FM. Because the weather sucks, and you need some theme music.
Ever seen an extraterrestrial? It can be hard to believe they exist unless you've seen one for yourself. What if I told you I've seen them my whole life, but have never had a witness who shared the encounter with me? Now, what if I told you I saw four of them, two with blue skin, and there are over 20 witnesses to this CE5 event? My new book, The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, documents actual accounts from real witnesses, many of which have gone on record to attest to this otherworldly reality. Be a part of the quantum paradigm shift that is taking place right now. Go to johnpolkmedia.com to get your copy of The Blue Beings, Visitation at the UFO Conference, on sale right now at johnpolkmedia.com. That's johnpolkmedia.com.
This is Ronnie LeBlanc, author of Monsterland, Encounters with UFOs, Bigfoot, and Orange Orbs, and you're listening to Shift Happens on KTLK, The Fringe FM.
KTLK Digital Broadcast. We rock the paranormal talk.
This Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with my pinch hitter co-host for tonight, Brad Harris, our associate producer. And we are here tonight with Jimmy Pearson from Fascination Street and Kelly Farmer from Explaining Esoterica. You can catch both of their shows out there on YouTube. Jimmy's show's on Saturdays, Kelly's is on Fridays. Go check it out. They've got some good shows already. They're both pretty new up-and-coming shows, but they're off to a pretty killer start, if you ask me. Now, real quick, Bradley, no. Just no. Okay, and so, but now real quick for the audience that's just maybe tuning in, or in case you missed it earlier, although you are listening to a live stream and all of you guys in the audience are hanging out, you are listening to a pre-recorded show that we did on Wednesday. And the reason being because we're at Conscious Life Expo at the time of you hearing this, and we didn't want to just not have a show. And on top of that, you know, Kelly's show goes on at the same time as mine. And then on top of that, Jimmy's over there in England. So this is a pretty rare happening, the fact that we've got all these people on the same show at the same time. You know, so it's kind of a special event here. Once in a lifetime, maybe once in a year time. We might do this, you know, I'm sure we'll figure out how to do it again sometime. So anyway, so if you have any questions in the chat room, I mean, you can ask them, but we're not going to be able to answer them because we're not here. So there you go. And obviously the phone lines are closed. I hope I explained that clearly enough. So anyway.
I'll give out Gigi's cell phone number. You guys can call him live.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And definitely. If you are asking questions in the chat room, yes, yes, no, yes, yes, no, and yes.
Yeah.
And if you don't like that, reverse.
I'm just going to take a
repeat
wild
and rinse.
I'm going to take a wild guess. I'm going to take a wild guess at a question that might be asked right now. And it's probably by Neil, and my answer is probably no. How about that?
goodness, Neil.
I love you, Neil. You're good people.
Yeah, he is.
He is, actually. So,
yeah.
Now, okay. All right, before I get into that, let's take it back a couple of hops and a skip. So what, I can trace it back for me, for example, there was one, obviously I've always been interested in kind of in these sort of topics whether it's conspiracies or ufology or, lost civilizations or archaeology or anything like that. Like, it's always definitely kind of caught my attention, but it wasn't until I saw a documentary, and a good chunk of it was Michael Cramo from Forbidden Archaeology. And once I heard what he had to say, and my friend like sat me down, made me watch it, and that really sparked the fire. Like, whoa, okay, there's something going on here. And I started doing research and blah blah blah. Next thing you know, I'm doing these radio shows. So like, that was kind of the catalyst. And funny enough, we actually just had him on a couple of weeks ago. That was pretty cool for me. But yeah, by the way, folks, go check that out. Good show. So now Jimmy and Kelly, I guess we'll let you go one at a time here, whichever one. So what was your, if you can recall, there must have been some sort of, whether it was a sighting or an event or just a bit of knowledge that you heard or something that you saw that, kind of turned on that light bulb that you are now currently, hovering around.
Kelly, ladies first.
There you go.
Sure. So, what got me? So, it's kind of a multi-tiered answer, I guess, is the best way to put it. Because for me, what got me into the whole alien ufology side of it was an abduction experience that I had when I was four. But when it comes to the esoteric side of it, that came when I was a teenager. But the ancient civilizations piece of it came when I was in college, and really I was introduced to the Minoan civilization, which some people actually point to the fact could be Atlantis. So it was really that kind of kicked off that final piece of it for me, and it was kind of combining all of those together at that time that really got me into it. So that's been something I've been really researching and getting into deeply in the past decade. But when it comes to doing a show, that's only been a year. So,
okay. Now you said, okay. Yeah. Good answer. And now you said, so the original thing would be the, when you were 4 years old, the whole abduction thing, which, I would love to get into that maybe in a little bit, but I want to get Jimmy's answer first. But before we get to Jimmy, now you said the Minoan civilization now part of my ignorance, but is that, I think, isn't that the native New Zealand folks?
No, the Minoan is in the Mediterranean. It's really what came right before the Greeks, as you know them. So when you think about ancient Greece, the Minoans were the precursors in the Mediterranean and actually controlled that whole area.
Okay.
So for them, what happened was they had this really great thriving culture during the Bronze Age, the early Bronze Age. And then basically there was an earthquake and a tidal wave, and it wiped out their main port on one of the nearby islands. And it basically enabled the Greeks to take them over. But they fit a lot of the criteria when you hear about people talk about Atlantis, not from the spiritual point of view, but from the textbook point of view and the Plato's description of it.
Okay. So the geological point of view, I guess.
The geological point of view, how successful they were, how much of the area they controlled, what sort of supplies and products they had, and interactions with other countries, things like that, from that point of view.
Okay.
So not from the, starseed point of view, but it's from the other side of it.
Right,
exactly. The mythological point of view.
There, perfect. Yeah, there you go.
There we go.
Now, so just in your opinion, where do you think the original, the OG homeland for Atlantis was?
Well, see, for me, because there's so much evidence that points to the Minoan civilization, that for me, that's where I believe that Atlantis was.
So right there off the... Okay, so not like... So not in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean.
It would be kind of... in the Mediterranean, it's easily accessible to parts of Africa, just like it's described by Plato. And it's accessible to, obviously, Italy, just like Plato described. So then it just kind of creates this whole circle, and it kind of describes it. And it's possible that it was higher up, and then this tidal wave came. And that's documented historically. That there was an earthquake and a tidal wave happened, and it kind of dropped some of it. So,
yeah, and part of the reason I ask is because with the level of technology that that it seems logical enough to think that they probably had that was lost during that catastrophe. I would imagine that it seems like they had the ability to travel all around the world. So So, for example, I could imagine they might have, definitely a good little spot right there out by the Mediterranean, but maybe that might not have necessarily been. I mean, I don't know. I don't know what I'm talking about. But maybe they had another spot, too. You know what I mean?
Well, no, yeah. And what the thing is that what the idea is that the main, the headquarters or, the OG place is that. But they traveled around the world and controlled an area that included basically from, the edge of Spain, the western edge of Spain, all the way across that whole bottom part of Europe and all the way down into Africa, like Morocco and everything along those lines. So it's like that whole area they controlled into the Atlantic. Therefore, they were called Atlantis. So, obviously, there's no way to prove it. Right now, unless, they do some more research into it. But there's a lot of researchers that have actually pointed to the fact that that could be the case.
Yeah, and I think there's so much more, once again, instead of, don't get me wrong, I love space. I'm fascinated by it. The Cosmos, that TV show, I can watch that stuff all day. I can, let's go to Mars, let's do it. I'm all down for that. But we haven't even explored 97% of the ocean. And, a good example of this is, I forget the names and the details, but there's, I'm sure a lot of people know what I'm talking about here. There's an ancient city off the coast of India, I think more on the west side of India. And, the locals have been saying for, since recorded history, there was a big badass city right here off the coast here, and the whole tidal wave thing happened, which, of course, look at any sort of facet of history from any culture, any side of the world, they all talk about this massive flood and this massive rush of water covering everything, and the rise of the sea level. And, you know, they've been talking about the city that's right there, and, you know, the locals have been trying to get, you know, local government to, you know, go down there and explore it. It was a very big religious, you know, situation for them. Like, it was a very prominent spot that they wanted to prove, but the India's government never quite got on board, and it took a random group of, I want to say they were from England. It was either from England or America, but there was a little, it was just like a crew of like, I don't know, 10 or 15 people. And they even hired the help of the locals in India. They had like some pretty primitive, like it wasn't anything super fancy. They obviously didn't have a lot of funding, but all it took was, you know, a couple of weeks. They went scuba diving around the area, and sure enough, they found this massive city with all these structures and all the same depictions that are depicted in the ancient texts and everything. It's like, man, if a group of 10 or 15 people on their own budget can prove something like this, just imagine what we can prove with something like Atlantis. If we actually, if we spent the amount of money and the amount of effort that we're spending on going to Mars and even just thinking about going to Mars, just imagine if we applied that to underwater and what kind of stuff we would uncover about our past. And I think that's kind of a huge mistake that we're making right now. You know, once again, I feel like we should probably understand where we come from and how we came from it before we, you know, move forward. I don't know. That's just my thing.
Well, you've also got to ask yourself how much red tape's involved as well, Gigi. You know, because you've got so many places like Egypt. And I mean, I remember back when, you know, there was saying that there was nothing else to find, and, you know, people that want to excavate in Turkey what was possibly the site of Noah's Ark, and, you know, they're just not granted any access at all. But then you have sort of like guerrilla archaeologists that came along, like John Anthony West and Robert Schock, that kind of changed the whole kind of concept and people's opinions and views with, you know, all these great things, which, you know, we're not being told the truth on a lot of these things. And that's sad, mate. That's really, really sad.
Yeah, I mean, not only are we not being told the truth, I mean, yeah, they're going quite out of their way in a lot of cases to withhold it and sweep a lot of archaeological finds under the rug. And I mean, look no further than forbidden archaeology. It's 900 pages of all of these, almost 1,000 pages of all these discoveries that throw a complete catastrophic monkey wrench into our understanding of history and evolution and everything else. And
I mean, is it the fact that they're too afraid that they're going to have to like rewrite the whole of history, that it's going to kind of be like a total paradigm shift and blow people's worlds apart and what they believed, what they didn't believe, and things like that?
I think
Jimmy,
it's definitely
Jimmy, maybe perhaps it's you know, let's focus. Maybe they're trying to divert the focus and like, hey, let's look at Mars and go on somewhere else, rather than realize that what we have here is, you know, the jewel of the universe. You know, we have like a planet that's so unique, and I mean, look at our atmosphere. It's just like a protective shield, you know what I mean, that protects us and has just like saved our asses so many times. So it's just like, yeah, man, absolutely. We can go on for days, you know.
Spot on, Brad.
Yeah, man. And I think it's definitely a little bit of both, you know, and even more, because yeah, definitely, you know, there's definitely the point of, you know, having to rewrite history, just, you know, just from a really dumb financial aspect. Like, yeah, you have to rewrite all the textbooks. But big whoop-de-doo, you know, you would think that the value of the knowledge is more valuable than how much money you want to save by not rewriting textbooks, right? So that's part of it, but that can't be the whole answer, right? And
it's throwing in credibility, isn't it? The credibility of all these fantastic institutions that have been out there excavating and this, that, and the other, and then it throws their credibility into the air. You know, these people are priding themselves on being the best at what they do, but yet they're committing the biggest crime by fraud.
Yeah, and like you know, we were talking about the other week with Michael. Yeah, there's that one famous case with I forget his name, but he found these, you know, giant skeletons out there in the Americas that were, and he reported it to the Smithsonian, and the guy from the Smithsonian basically said, you know, I'm paraphrasing here, but he's like, if you would have taken a second to think about what we're teaching our kids, you would have second guessed, you're, you know, coming out with this information. Or in other words, if you wanted to keep your job, you would have not reported these fines. You know what I mean? And it's like, yeah, there's definitely some pressure. A lot of people have lost their careers over the years just by genuinely making a legitimate discovery and it doesn't match the story that we're being told. And so, but then you got to get into why? And I think a part of it is, you know, if you control the understanding of history, you pretty much control everything on so many different levels, psychologically, even physically, you know, especially now in America, the physical part is not so much of a big thing. Whereas in other parts of the world, you know, religious heritage is everything over there. You know, like in the Middle East, for example, like if you can prove that you have heritage to this, then the other side will back down like, oh, okay, yeah, you know, can't beat that. But in America, nobody gives a hell about that, right? But the rest of the world, that's a really big thing. And there's a lot of different factors there. But okay, we got a few minutes left before the break. I'm gonna take this all the way back to Jimmy. What was the initial thing, the initial experience, the initial thing you saw that kickstarted this whole, this whole journey that you're on today?
Right. It's nowhere near as exciting as Kelly's, to be fair. So I'm prepared to be bored. I remember when I was growing up, I was a wee lad, and my dad had actually borrowed a VHS video. Now, for anyone that's young in the audience, you might want to Google what a VHS video is. and it was this documentary. It was very much like Chariots of the Gods, but it had William Shatner in it. And he was visiting all these sort of like old sites and showing us all these like old tribes, but they were kind of like dressed up in like this wicker outfit, which pretty much resembled a spaceman, like how we'd see like a 1980s astronaut dressed. And I mean, bearing in mind, these people had no real kind of contact with the outside world and things like that. And that's what really kickstarted it, as well as being like an absolute Star Wars geek as a kid.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That'll help for sure.
But that documentary, I can't remember the name of it, but I have recently found it on YouTube in its entirety, and I sent it to my dad, reminiscing with it. So it's very, very cool,
man. Well, as soon as you if you ever remember what it's called, or you find that link, make sure you share it to me, because
I've
definitely never seen that. Sounds interesting though.
It's pretty weird, because when you watch it now, it just looks so sort of like old and grainy, and the music's all kind of whiny, and you're like, well, I don't remember it being like that.
Yeah. Yeah, it really is interesting to watch like old, or it's like old sitcoms or old, you know, multimedia productions. It's like you almost like you feel, especially with like sitcoms, like early 80s, like early 90s sitcoms, it's like you actually feel embarrassed for the human race that this is where we were at in entertainment. Like, this is actually what people thought was funny. Like, or this is what people thought was good production, like, back then. It's just like, man.
Exactly.
Just hand on the forehead. Like, oh. It's almost painful.
One that I do think stands the test of time, though, is The Prisoner. I love that. The original with Patrick McGowan from the 60s was amazing.
Oh, man. Yeah, I've never actually seen that.
Have you not?
No, I haven't, actually. I've heard all about
it. Okay, keep an eye on your messenger after the show.
All right, will do. Definitely.
Uncle Jimmy's going to hook you up, Gigi. No worries.
All right, I got another uncle now. It's about time. All right, so let's go ahead and... Okay, because I'm going to throw you guys a couple of curveballs in the last half hour.
Uh-oh.
I just want to get your opinions on a couple of subjects that you might not necessarily talk about all the time. You know, that's one thing I kind of like to do, you know, is like really, you know, intelligent people that are focused on one thing. I think it's always healthy to get their perspectives on things that's not necessarily on their business plan. You know, it's not something they're getting paid to research, you know, just a fresh, genuine opinion on other mysteries going on in the world. And I think that's always fun to do. And I think it might even be healthy to do. So we'll get to a little bit of that when we come back from this commercial break here. Oh, let me get my, oh my goodness, where do we go? Here we are. All right, ladies and gentlemen. By the way, quick reminder for anybody that's just now tuning in or you still don't understand what's happening. This is, although it is a live stream, this is a pre-recorded show from a couple of days ago. So all of your questions and everything in the chat room, we're obviously not going to be able to answer because at the time that you're hearing this, we are at the Conscious Life Expo. So that's what's happening. And with that having been forementioned, haha, didn't say it. Ladies and gentlemen, you're listening to The Fringe FM here. This is Shift Happens. I'm your host, Gigi, along with my pinch hitter co-host for the night, Brad Harris. And we're here with Jimmy Pearson and Kelly Farmer. We'll be back in just a few short minutes.
Yeah.
Don't go anywhere.
I've got a secret I cannot say. They might have moved me to give it away. You've got
some... Hey, folks. Guess what the number one phrase that Life Change Tea receives by email? You ready? We love this tea. We love this tea. Time after time, week after week, we love this tea. Life Change Tea gives you more energy, a beautiful cleansing, and fulfills its slogan perfectly. The tea that makes you go. So if you want to be on your health game, log on to getthetea.com and order Life Change Super Strength Tea. Packages come in a 1 month supply, and when you brew this stuff, wait until you see the results. Aren't we all about the results? And with a lot of people's health struggling, we can use a little bit of help. Doctors will tell you disease starts in the gut. So log on to getthetea.com. That's getthetea.com. Be our next email saying, I love this tea. I mean, I love this tea. Get the tea at getthetea.com. Helping America one tea bag at a time.
Are you intrigued by paranormal talk radio? You'll love the new Paranormal Radio app from TalkStream Live. You'll find a great selection of talk shows covering UFOs, ghosts, strange phenomena, and much more. Download the Paranormal Radio app now and start listening to the very best in paranormal talk entertainment, including the network you're listening to right now, the Paranormal Radio app, free in Google Play and the iOS App Store.
All right, man, this is Crow 777, and you are listening to The Fringe FM.
Okay, nurse, let's get this man to the ER stat.
Right away, doctor.
We see this every day. Heart attack or angina pain due to blocked and clogged arteries. Chelation can remove obstructions or blockages from arteries and help avoid painful and expensive surgery. Now there's Angioprim. It's a liquid oral chelation product that you take with juice. You start to feel the results fast. Angioprim increases blood flow all over the body, and that means more energy and strength to take on the day with less aches and pains. 60 years of research has gone into chelation. And Angioprim is the result, a safe and easy way to unblock your veins and arteries from buildup that slow circulation.
Paging Dr. Jones, please report to the emergency room right away.
Log on now for a special radio offer from Angioprim. That's angioprim.com/radio. A-N-G-I-O-P-R-I-M. Angioprim.com/radio or call 877-882-7221. That's 877-882-7221.
Want to know what's on The Fringe FM? Check out our schedule at thefringe.fm.
Don't feed the archons. Feed ducks instead. And listen to Shift Happens on The Fringe FM. Fridays, 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific. Cortana out. Quack.
Poor water quality is a major health issue, and it's only getting worse. Municipalities can't keep up, standards have dropped, and pollutants are increasing. Where does it all end? It ends by keeping the pollutants outside of your home with HydroCare's advanced systems available at Wave Home Solutions. No less than the best purification materials and processes have been developed by HydroCare to provide you with healthy, clean water for drinking, cooking, and showering. HydroCare far surpasses the competition in removing chlorine, odors, iron, lead, chemicals, limescale, and much more. Don't settle for less when it comes to your water. We'll take care of the toughest water problems for you, whether it's from a city or well source. Satisfaction guaranteed. For more information, call 888-997-WAVE. That's 888-997-WAVE. Or go to bestwater123.com. That's bestwater123.com.
WAVE Home Solutions for a healthy, comfortable home.
Live for 3 hours every Saturday night, it's a show that engages the mind, makes you think, and maybe even challenge what you think you know. Hi, I'm Jeremy Scott of Into the Paranormal, where we talk about topics that are anything but mainstream, somewhere between abnormal and paranormal. Bring an open mind and join us for Into the Paranormal, live Saturdays at 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern on The Fringe FM.
KTOK Digital Broadcasting, The Fringe.fm, Napa Valley, California, Little Rock, Arkansas.
This is Tom Sherman. Down here at Banning College, we're promoting a blood drop.
Oh, shit.
Not guilty.
Welcome to the Sound of America. It was like the AM 580. Lay back. The sheep. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb. Little lamb.
Eat salt, Adam the apple.
God told me so! To my base!
You cannot be saved.
Follow me in our room.
Good to know that he's walking with me.
Big rock is a weapon.
The devil is a black dog.
Into the fog.
Let him cast the first stone.
Jesus, Jesus.
And you have fallen into the love that needs to be designed by the Lord. Hallelujah, y'all. I want to hear a couple of hallelujahs.
Hitter co-host for tonight, our associate producer Brad Harris. You can follow him on Twitter at ADSBradHarris. And you can follow me over at GGRabbit1. And you can follow our show over at Shift Happens Pod. And we're here tonight with Jimmy Pearson from Fascination Street and Kelly Farmer from Explaining Esoterica, both of which those shows you can catch on YouTube at your leisure. And now before we get going again, once again, I do want to remind anybody that's just now tuning in, or if you just don't quite understand what's going on, although this is a live stream and you guys are all hanging out in the chat room together, you are hearing a pre-recorded show that is being streamed live. We did this 2 days ago prior to what is your now, if that makes sense. So any questions you have in the chat room, obviously, we're not going to be able to answer them. Obviously, the phone lines aren't going to be open. We just figured we'd give you guys a show for this week while we're over here at the Conscious Life Expo. So there you go. I hope that clears that up. Now, real quick. Let's wait for him. Okay, so Jimmy.
Yep.
So I'm curious. Off the beaten path here, I see you vaping over there. And, actually, yes. I used to own a, well, I still own it, an e-juice company, but the FDA has basically crippled us as far as being able to do business. And I have a lot of colorful language I could use to describe that situation, but we'll just leave it at that. And so I'm, because we had a lot of problems, you know, when it came to shipping internationally, like Canada, we basically couldn't ship them anything unless it was like zero nicotine and no flavors, which is like, what's the point? So, and then like Australia, I think, they can't buy more when Australia can't even, yeah, Australia is pretty crazy. But I think what I heard about England was you can't buy more than like, you know, you can only buy a certain amount at a time, like 15 milliliters at a time, or maybe it's 10 milliliters at a time.
No. We have shops where you can go in and they'll kind of blend your own kind of flavors and bits and pieces. Yeah, I mean, yeah, there's no limit at all. I mean, we go into a local shop and I get the little 10 milligram bottles, milliliters even, sorry.
Yeah.
And, you know, I pick up like 10 of those at a time, no problem. So, yeah, no, it's all good over here for the vaping. It's, the vaping industry is quite big, as I say. You've got like vape lounges where you can go in, vape there, and then say, you know, buy whatever one you want. I mean, I only vape because I use CBD because I have a spine problem.
Right.
Apart from that, I wouldn't vape normally or smoke. So,
you don't have any nicotine in there. It's just CBD.
Yeah, no, I have nicotine.
Okay. Yeah, you know what's funny about what's interesting about, wait, hold on 1 second. So, you mentioned 10 milligram or milliliter rather. Do they sell any bigger bottles than 10 mil?
Yeah, absolutely. As I say, you can go into the vape lounges and buy it all there. And
okay,
I don't actually have one handy, but there's, you can get 60 milliliter bottles and all sorts. Yeah.
Well, and here's the thing about nicotine itself, which a lot of people don't know, is, I mean, obviously when you smoke cigarettes, I mean, that's just, you're just killing yourself, right? There's all kinds of, you know, it's just terrible for you, all kinds of thousands of chemical reactions.
Like 250 chemicals, isn't there, in a cigarette?
Yeah, and some, like a lot of them, like rat poison. Why is that in there, you know? When it comes to vaping nicotine, like my partner would tell you, you know, he's like a chemist, my business partner, and he'll, you know, there's only, when you really boil it down, there's initially only like 5 or 6 chemical combustions rather than like several hundred. And then on top of that, nicotine itself is actually what we call a nootropic, which is basically a vitamin for your brain rather than your body. And so that part of your brain that, let's say you're making a painting or you're writing a screenplay or you're writing music, that part of your brain that kicks in when you get in that creative zone, nicotine actually stimulates that part of your brain. So if you can get nicotine in a way that's not harmful, which as far as we know, vaping isn't very harmful, but we don't know. Yeah, fingers crossed, because we know it's not harmful to the lungs. We figured that out. But there's still some questions as to whether or not, especially with the coils, like, you know, the whole, anyway, we get, you know, I don't want to spend too much time on that. But I was just curious. Because I see you vaping over there. And I remember we had some restrictions when it came to England. I was just kind of curious for a second there. Now, okay.
That's strange. Yeah, absolutely strange.
Dude, in Australia, here's the thing about Australia is it's illegal to import nicotine into Australia. And with that said, nicotine doesn't grow in Australia. So how is e-juice getting there? Well, it's getting there illegally. But once it's there, then you're allowed to buy it, right? But it's the fact of getting it there that's illegal. So you've got this whole underground nicotine smuggling thing going on. it's such a weird little
Australia
situation.
Australia is crazy at the moment anyway, isn't it?
Yeah, there's a lot of, yeah. But, okay, so I'm going to ask you guys about, I want to get both of your opinions, Kelly and Jimmy, about the, this is something I talk about quite a lot on the show whenever it comes up. Like, I'll easily go on a good 15-minute rant about it, is the Apollo missions, the Apollo moon landing missions. And, you know, what I mean by that is, you know, I mean, obviously we're in space. That's obviously non-issue. We've got rovers on Mars. We've got things out there by Saturn and as far as Neptune. And, you know, we're obviously out there. But when it comes to humans getting past the Van Allen belt, which would have to have occurred, right, in order to go to the moon, there's so many, before I even get to my opinion about it, is this anything that you, either of you, have ever spent any, you know, amount of time actually looking into? Does it bother you at all, or is it just not really on the radar?
Kelly?
For me, I mean, it's something I haven't looked a whole lot into it, but I mean, it's something that I'm aware of and something that I do find interesting, the thought that maybe we haven't actually gone to the moon, and that whole idea of it being staged. That's something that's within my awareness, but it's not something I've looked into too deeply.
Okay.
See, I think we've been there, but the footage is fake.
See, that's where I'm at too. Like it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we've been there, and I think that we probably used a different form of technology other than strapping a human to a firecracker and yeah, just launching them up like a catapult, you know? I think
we've been out there a lot longer than has been specified as well.
I think so too. And, but here, see, it really comes down, like, this really wouldn't even be a question if it wasn't for NASA, you know, shooting themselves in the foot over and over again. You know, first of all, they lost all of the telemetry data, and they lost all of the, they literally said in the 90s, we would love to go back to the moon, but we lost all the technology to do it. What do you mean? What are you talking about? That's like saying, yeah, we invented the internet and we have computers, and then all of a sudden we wake up tomorrow, it's like, oh, we forgot how to make computers. Like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
Like, that's actually their official excuse.
I mean, the way they just kind of willed that guy out. Yeah. We can't do it. And I don't buy into that. I mean, you've got enough technology there. You have enough intelligent people there to be able to back engineer what you've already got. I mean, surely there must be sort of like someone there that was like, oh, I worked on the original. Yeah, I know that nut goes there and that washer goes there. And, you know, it's a weird one. And I don't know. Did you ever watch the film Operation Avalanche?
No, I don't think so.
That is a really, really good film. It's kind of like one of the first, like, first person films, kind of like the Blair Witch thing. But it's about a group of filmmakers that end up working for the CIA to help fake the footage for the moon landing. And they kind of come over to England and incorporate Stanley Kubrick into it. And it's an amazing film. It's been out for a couple of years now.
Wow, that sounds really – yeah, I just wrote that down. I'm going to check that out for sure. Yeah, there's
is that another link I've got? Send you GG.
Oh, yeah. Keep those. Yeah. Send me all the links you got, man. You've brought up.
No worries.
You've brought up more than a few tonight that have definitely sparked my curiosity. And yeah, there's just so many little, I mean, you know.
It's such a well-made film.
Man, and there is a, you know, it's a really good one. It's almost really good. Well, it is really good until the very end. Like, spoiler alert, they kind of like ruined it. But have you ever heard of the Dyatlov Pass incident? I probably butchered
that. Yeah, absolutely.
Name.
I actually work with a Russian lady, and we talk about that quite a lot, because they've just reopened the case, haven't they?
Oh, have they?
RT, yeah, I posted it out. I think it was last week. RT have reported that they are reopening the case into the incident.
Oh, wow. Well, I can't wait to see what they uncovered, because, yeah, that's one of the most, as far as modern mysteries go, like actual mysteries that happened recently, you know, you've got Coral Castle, you know, Lee Edward Skolden and that whole thing. You've got Falconelli and the whole mystery of the cathedral thing. And then you've got the Dyatlov Pass. Like, those are like the three, like, at least in my book, I'm sure there's other ones, but like, when you really look into it, it's like, dude, what actually could have possibly happened here? Like, this is insane. And they did a really good, there's a movie they made, I think it's called The Devil's Pass. It was on Netflix, it might still be, I don't know, but the movie was really good in the sense that a lot of the facts of the case and the investigations were all represented very clearly, and all the multiple different theories were represented, and it was all really good until the very, 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 very end, the last 10 minutes, they just ruined it by turning it into this whole ghost zombie thing. It's like, really? Really?
You took that whole movie? I hate it when they do that. I mean, have a bit more imagination, guys.
Yeah. Oh, and there's another one. I forget what it was called. Last Men on Mars or Last Days on Mars, something like that. It was a really good
Last
movie.
Days on Mars.
It was a great movie for the first 30 or 45 minutes. Like, I was fully entranced. Like, oh, I can't wait to see what happens. And then, zombies on the moon. Really? You took it there? You had the perfect setup. You could have gone in any direction. You picked zombies on the moon. Jesus Christ.
But, did you ever watch Beyond the Sky? I'm not sure if it came out under that name over in the States or another name.
No, I can't say that I have.
And that's UFOs, MK Ultra. Basically, you have a documentary filmmaker that goes out to this conference of experiences and UFO conference, and he just basically goes there to go and debunk the whole community and the conference and all the attendees and experiences. And it takes a bit of a turn. A very, very good film. I really enjoyed that, but it incorporates, as I say, UFOs, MK Ultra, all in one film.
All right. Yeah. I've just jotted that down just now. So I'm definitely taking notes here. And so, okay. And then, I don't know. There's so much I want to say right now, but we only have 11, well, really about 9 minutes. So now what do you guys think about, what do you guys think about Bigfoot? Because, we've been doing this show for over a couple of years. And then before this, I was co-hosting Beyond the Strange for a while. And out of all of my time doing all of this stuff, I think we did one episode on Beyond the Strange about Bigfoot. And then, what's funny is I actually had Steve Murillo. We had him on the show when was that, Brad? It was a few months ago. And ironically, we actually never got to Bigfoot. For some reason, it's just something we'd never have really talked about on here. And when it comes to the actual research into Bigfoot, there's a lot of dummies out there. There's obviously all these people aren't talking about nothing at all. And they have been talking about it all over the world for, thousands of years, but it gets kind of weird when it comes to all the evidence that's actually brought to the table is just like really poorly put together. It's very easily, I don't want to say debunked, but debunked. And it's just like really like if I dedicated my life to researching Bigfoot, I just have a feeling I would come up with something better than what they're coming up with. But I don't know. Once again, I don't really spend a whole lot of time looking into it. Have you guys ever come across anything that really sort of rocked the boat as far as that goes?
Kelly?
Well, I mean, for me, I do believe in Bigfoot. I mean, I know there's some people I know that's funnily enough, that's where they draw the line. They're like, I'll do aliens, I'll do ghosts, I'll do whatever. But they're like, Bigfoot, that's a no.
Isn't that crazy? Yeah.
But that being said, I mean, I do believe that there's Bigfoot, and I believe it's more of an interdimensional being. But that also being said, I mean, obviously it's a worldwide phenomenon that you hear about in other countries as well.
Yeah.
Which leads to the idea that maybe they're different, different species or different groups of them. I mean, for myself, the clearest evidence I have and I've talked about this a little bit, is basically from family stories. Because my mom is not from the U.S. She's from Vietnam, and there's actually the whole idea of the Vietnamese Bigfoot. And apparently there was this whole community of them, and they would come into town where my great-grandmother lived, and they'd interact with the people, come and buy salt, and then go back up into the mountains. Huh. So, like, it's totally normal. Like, it's not even, like, considered mythology. It's considered, like, part of the culture.
And that's in Vietnam, you said?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, I've never quite heard about that. Interesting. Yeah, there's definitely, you know, like I said, you know, there obviously everybody's talking about something, and it all seems to line up. There's obviously some kind of giant humanoid sort of figure, and there's a lot. There is some good evidence, you know, like Murillo and Alex Mistretta and like Rick Sennett, and you know, they went out on a little expedition a couple years ago, and they came across like a pretty proper, you know, footprint or foot indention in the ground or whatever, and it was like, okay, this is something. And yeah, there's really, it's kind of like you were saying, you know, like, okay, aliens, yeah, Palladians, yeah, Bigfoot, nah, you're crazy, right? It's yeah. Like, how are you drawing a line right there? But yeah, I really, you know, a lot of people talk about the Patterson footage, you know, like that's like the end all be all. But for me, it's just like, I don't know. I can't think of any other animal that moves in a fashion that looks like a human wearing a gorilla suit. And on top of that, you can see the soles of the shoes like on the bottom. It's just like, and it kind of, it's like, I think it gives the wrong, you know, it gives the wrong impression. It's like a lot of people think that that's all the evidence we have. It's like, no. In fact, most of us, you know, that's not even like on the table. Like we're looking at all this other stuff, like look over here. But most people see that and they get kind of turned off by it. And I think it does it a little bit of a shame, you know, that it's not as well researched, I guess you could say, as UFOs are, I guess, for instance. But hopefully somebody will change that. Now we've only got a couple minutes left. So, all right, I want to try to get this in. I want to ask both of you guys this. As of right now, what is at the peak of your curiosity? What kind of mystery or what is something that you're looking into right now that you haven't quite scraped the bottom of the barrel of that's still fascinating you at this moment?
That's a tough one, Gigi.
I'll answer really quickly, Jimmy, and then you can give a longer answer.
Okay, love.
All right, so I'm just going to say that for me, it's really kind of like I mentioned earlier, that whole like lost civilization idea. There's basically, in my mind, a period of time that we're missing with regards to between the Iron Age and the Bronze Age on the Earth. So there's some forgotten knowledge with regards to some civilizations, and that's really where like my focus really goes right now.
Man, I am right there with you. I'm right there with you. That's exactly where I'm at too. All right, and so how about you, Jimmy?
That's a pretty spot on answer. Yeah. I just finding out the mysteries. We're so fortunate to be able to do what we do. Yourself, Kelly, I, and our shows and the platforms that we have and the guests that we have. And, you know, I like to think that what we're doing is trying to find all of that together. Some of the guests we have on are truly amazing and everything like that. So everyone has their own stories and, you know, I love all of that all put together. The missing time, ancient civilizations, aliens, Bigfoot, the whole thing. I can't really say there's anything specific that I'm really, really into. I just love the whole thing, Gigi. I mean, one thing that is kind of captured like the imagination at the moment is the new moon that they've just found off Neptune.
Oh, yeah. I just barely heard about that.
Yeah, yeah. They've given it a really cool name. They've called it Hippocamp.
There it is, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, if you're going to find a new planet, you're going to give it some decent name. I mean, Hippocamp.
Yeah, you might as well call it Pop-Tart Syrup.
There we go. Strawberry Pop-Tart.
All right. Well, now we got just a couple minutes left. So real quick, and within a couple minutes, go ahead and let everybody know where they can follow you on social media, YouTube, and everything else.
Kelly?
So for me, you can find me quite easily on YouTube. Just look up Explaining Esoterica. I'm also on Twitter at EXP Esoterica. Also on Instagram and Facebook as well, under Explaining Esoterica. So it's pretty easy.
There you go.
There we go. Yeah, pretty much the same here as well. I'm available on Twitter at Rev Jimmy Pearson, R-E-V Jimmy Pearson, P-E-A-R-S-O-N. Also available on Facebook under just Jimmy Pearson. We also have a Fascination Street fan page on Facebook, and also on YouTube, Fascination Street with Jimmy and Mika.
All right, there you go. And okay, so thank you guys so much for coming on. And also, if you guys have time, if you want to hang out for a couple minutes after the show, I'm going to be chilling right here. But if you have to go, that's cool too. No worries either way. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Shift Happens Here for The Fringe FM. I'm your host, Gigi, and our co-host for tonight was Brad Harris. And as always, our associate producer is Brad Harris. And there you go. Special thanks to Eric Awakening Man, our roaming reporter, and Dennis Koch for all the promotional goodness that he does. And as always, all blames and faults go to Fran. That's right. Hashtag Fran's fault. And thanks for tuning in, guys. But don't go too far, because coming up in a couple hours here is Ryan Gable with The Secret Teachings right here on The Fringe FM. All right, folks, I'm at the Conscious Life Expo. I'm going to get back to my boogie. We'll see you guys later. Cheers.